Welcome to week 3 on energy analysis. If you are joining me from the colder countries at this time of the year, you are likely in a warm room now. And if it's early in the morning, it may be that you are sipping on a delicious cup of coffee to start the day well. If this is not the case, feel free to pause the lecture and get that cup of coffee or tea. For both the heating of your room and the heating of water or milk for that cup of coffee, energy is required. Hereby, a distinction can be made between the final energy use and the primary energy use. This lecture will address the distinction. A nice way to discuss the concepts of primary energy and final energy use is by relating it to our energy system. Our energy system can be seen as a whole of 5 sequential activities. First of all, you have the winning of energy. This can take place through energy carriers, such as coal, oil, or natural gas extracted from the earth. The energy contained within these energy carriers can be categorized as primary energy. Primary energy is thus the energy found in its original or natural form. In addition, primary energy can also be extracted from resources such as wind, the sun, and water. But hey, we can't do much with just crude oil, right? Therefore, the next step is conversion, whereby the primary energy is converted into secondary energy, which is contained in energy carriers for which our society is designed. The most important secondary energy carrier is electricity, and this conversion takes place in power plants. In the conversion from primary to secondary energy, large losses typically occur. For example, in a coal-fired power plant, a conversion efficiency of 40% is common. This means that for 40 joules of electricity, 100 joules of coal as a primary energy carrier is required. Now, this energy has to go from the plant to the consumers, right? The next step of transportation, distribution, and storage takes care of this function. When taking the example of electricity again, this electricity is transported over the national high voltage lines to the regional mid voltage lines, then to the low voltage lines in your neighborhood, and finally towards your home. Also in this step, some losses occur and an efficiency of 95% can be assumed. The storage step is less relevant for electricity, but far more practical for oil. The next step of final conversion and end use take place at the user, such as you. This I will elaborate with an example. For this example, we go back to the cup of coffee you may be drinking now. As mentioned before, you heated up water or milk for the cup of coffee in, let's assume, an electric coffee machine. During that process, the secondary energy contained in electricity is converted into heat, which is then transferred to your coffee, heating it up. Now, assuming your coffee machine has an energy efficiency of 80%. This means that 80% of the energy input to your coffee machine is actually used to heat up your milk or water as useful energy. The remaining 20% of the energy input escapes the machine as heat or goes into the heating of the cup. Now, to heat 350 milliliters of water to 83 degrees in 3.5 minutes, the theoretical required amount of energy or useful energy is 581 kilowatt. This means that for the coffee machine with an efficiency of 80%, the total energy input or electricity use for the conversion equals 726 watt. The 726 watt of energy required for the conversion at home is what we call the final energy use. The useful energy use can thus be defined as the energy we actually and effectively use to conduct our activities and fulfill our needs. We can analyze the entire chain efficiency from the primary energy in coal all the way to the useful energy use by multiplying the efficiency per sector of the energy chain. If we collect the data from this lecture, we get the following. A winning efficiency of 95% as losses occur and energy is required for transportation and processing of the resources. A conversion efficiency of 40%, transportation efficiency of 95%, and finally the boiler efficiency of 80%. For this case, the overall efficiency from primary energy use to useful energy is 30%. For a simple process like making coffee, the energy loss is thus significant, and you may think we are very inefficient, which is true. But it can get even worse. For example, boiling an egg has an overall chain efficiency of 2%. You may ask yourself why this loss is so large and how we can improve this. However, a 100% conversion rate from primary energy to useful energy is impossible. Thermal processes, such as the conversion from energy in coal to electricity, are bounded to a theoretical maximum conversion efficiency, called the Carnot efficiency. However, in the past years, strong technological advances have been made which have increased the efficiency of power plants, reduced power losses during transportation, and improved the efficiency of industrial machines and home appliances. With this said, I hope you can also contribute in improving our energy efficiency in the future. Thank you.